Good morning.
Good morning, everybody.
Morning.
Good morning. How are things in your world, Brent?
Things are fantastic. It's cold here, but not as cold as you are.
Yeah.
Them's fighting words.
Jerk.
Said the Zony to the Canadian.
Yeah, the Zony. That's an interesting nickname, geographic nickname. What are you? I'm a Zony, man. I'm a Zony.
I'm a Zony. But if we got it from California, because that's what the Californians used to call us. So.
And you call them Fornies? Yo,
I think we went there. Yeah. We're not
the Canadian. The Canadian me is now picturing a whole string of Forney jokes. Like, we've always traditionally had Newfie jokes in Canada anyway.
You're right. Man. Hey, it's coffee time for us.
It is coffee time. Welcome aboard to all our guests who joined us here this morning. That's very cool, as always. And Brent, we have a very special guest with us today as well. You want to go ahead and make some introductions?
Yeah, absolutely. I'll have her introduce herself, but we have with us today Tanya. We forgot to ask how to say your last name, though. Seidel.
That's correct.
Oh, got it on the first try.
Nice
I'm feeling job good
today.
You are in the Zony.
We're going to talk about inclusion and accessibility and some cool stuff like that. You've written some stuff about it, and that's how we got in contact with you. We've been wanting to talk about this for a long time. It's a super important topic, and it's about time we have many, many more open discussions about it. So today's the day we kick that off and start to address it a little bit more than maybe we have in the past. So before we get there, though, just give us a little bit of introduction on who Tanya is.
Sure. Tanya Seidel. I work for Artisan eLearning. We're a small custom eLearning development organization and create content for a bunch of different clients of all different sizes, public, private, nonprofit, associations, you name it. I've been with Artisan, just had my 5-year anniversary, so that was pretty exciting. But prior to working with Artisan, I actually worked for Trivanis, the makers of Lectora, and spent close to 8 years with them, helping kind of in a lot of different areas. I led some of our training efforts along with our product management efforts and did a lot of work with the products there, including spearheading a lot of the efforts that we took at the time to make Lectora a tool that can be used to create accessible e-learning.
Very, very cool. And our official topic today, our official topic today, we're using the phrase inclusive design. It was, we were chatting though, you know, ahead of our conversation here today, it's a fairly broad kind of moniker. And certainly in the e-learning world, we've also, you know, had, the addition of the notion of accessibility of content, you know, as well. So maybe give us a little sketch of how those two things, what those two things are, how they relate to each other, you know, from your perspective.
Yeah, inclusive design is probably what I'd consider the broader umbrella, and we can't have accessibility without inclusive design. I wrote down a couple of little quotes here that I found along blogs and whatnot along the way that I thought were super interesting and worth saying out loud. Inclusive design doesn't specifically target people with disabilities. That's where kind of accessibility comes into play. But it strives to fundamentally redesign a product so that the barrier doesn't exist in the first place. And so it seems like this inclusive design is something that several companies out there, I know Microsoft has been really super vocal about it in recent times, that they're really striving to make this a practice within their organizations. And it's exciting for me because, like I said, you can't have accessibility without inclusive design. So I'm hoping that, you know, if we don't embrace the concept in its larger umbrella form, if we can at least begin to embrace some of the parts, including accessibility in e-learning, that's going to get us just closer to the ultimate goal.
Hmm. Yeah. One of the really cool things that you're mentioning Microsoft being, you know, very prominent these days about, you know, pushing forward on inclusive design and accessibility. And I mean, from a tool vendor perspective, we've had accessibility has often been, you know, a tick box, say in RFPs and that sort of thing for forever. You know, it's been there, but it's really kind of cool. But that's typically been, you know, focused mostly on from, you know, government agencies. And what's really been cool the last 3 or 4 years, let's say, is seeing that that becoming more and more important and recognized within like private sector organizations, where, you know, in the government agencies and that realm, there's a, you know, a legal mandate to be, you know, have these, you know, accessibility requirements met. But it's really cool to see it broadening beyond just that, that it's, you know, private organizations are recognizing it and saying, you know what, this is important, this is good. And it's not just because someone's wagging at a finger and saying, you know, thou shalt, you know, from a regulatory perspective in that sense. It's been a really neat trend to see that increase in questions about that, from a broader range of groups as we talk to people.
Yeah, I think that, you know, some of the principles behind accessibility really just equate to good design, you know? And so if what you're doing is trying to create content where you just are ticking the boxes, you know, okay, thanks, I guess. But at the end of the day, I think what we're really striving for is usability, and usability across a broader spectrum of users. So I think if we begin to embrace some of these things a little bit more, it's not that it's just meeting a set of requirements, it's doing the right thing by learners and by people out there who are taking your courses and using that kind of stuff. And you know, along the way, the laws have gotten a little bit stricter. And so I think the fact that more people are embracing some of this is a little bit of a side effect of those laws becoming a little bit stricter. But there have been organizations out there in the public realm, if you will, that have gotten into a little bit of hot water over this stuff. You know, Winn-Dixie a couple years back got themselves into a little bit of trouble because they had someone file a suit against them because they could not complete online transactions using Winn-Dixie's online shopping site. So, you know, it's no longer just about ADA accessible ramps in the front of your building. You know, it's recognizing that the internet and the web as a whole is a whole new method of accessing these places, these products, these services, and that that too needs to be accessible.
Yeah, it's so, I mean, we, those of us who don't have something that that you know, is either a barrier, we just use the internet and we go at it, and we don't often really pause and even think about just how absolutely crucial that is to so many of the things that help us just carry out our daily life. And if we faced a barrier in using them, then there's a barrier to, you know, simply, you know, continuing a regular or you know, something approximating the same lifestyle, the same, you know, functions that people, everybody else takes for granted.
Yeah, you know, we were working with a client recently, still are working with them on creating an accessible course, and they had someone in a SME call that we were on who was, I can't remember if totally or partially blind, but they were talking about, well, do we need to go completely, you know, very strict 508 standards, or can we, you know, implement some things and do our best, but maybe not take it to the letter of the law? That type of thing. And they were like, well, you know, the fact of the matter is that we have this instructor-led training that we can facilitate for anybody who needs to come. So even if there's somebody in the audience out there who does have complete blindness or vision problems to where they can't take the online course, they can just come in and we'll just do that. And she kind of spoke up and she was like, excuse me, and how would you like me to come in? She was like, I don't have a car, you know, I don't drive. Would you like me to get on a bus? I need to arrange transportation, you know? And so when you start hearing people say those types of things, you know, for those of us that don't have these type of disabilities that we deal with on a day-to-day basis, it just kind of blows your mind like, oh yeah, wow, there's a whole lot more obstacles that that person has to jump through to do this than we do.
Yeah, walking a mile in someone else's shoes, really. You don't have that experience, and it doesn't register for you. It's the privilege, you know, that we have, so many of us. So, yeah. Just tossing, noticing Mark's got a couple of notes. First off, Mark had to drop a few windows, which I presumed meant browser windows, but I had a vision, Mark, of you going around your house because, I don't know, the birds were singing too loudly or something. So anyway, that was my first reaction to your comment. But Mark has thrown in, the value in a broader and varied abilities has proven a win-win across the spectrum. Wide differences of users, employees, you know, and differences. Yeah. Being able to bring more viewpoints into any project is always super, super helpful. I thought of this in the drive-in this morning, a week or two ago. So we've had a pounding of snow and crappy rain weather up and down here in Eastern Ontario the last couple of weeks. A lot of school closures, and I saw a cartoon go by in one of my social media feeds of a bunch of kids at the steps of a school, and the janitor, the maintenance person, is shoveling off the steps, and the ramp hasn't been shoveled, and the quote is, yeah, but if you shovel the ramp first, then we can all use it. It's not, the ramp isn't an exclusively only for the, you know, in this case, the student in the wheelchair. It's there for everybody. So if that becomes, solving that problem actually solves everybody's problem in that way. It was really well put, succinct, I think, explanation of some of these things that we're talking about. So.
Yeah, it's I was just going to just throw in real quick, as instructional designers, when we talk about, you know, just making good design that is going to be accessible, how much do we rely on our tools to do some of that heavy lifting for us, as opposed to us having to think about it and go through it? Because, I mean, to be honest, you know, I think, you know, I think there's a lot of instructional designers out there that will just assume that if they publish it in a certain format or to SCORM or to something like that, that the tool is just going to be able to, you know, do the things that it needs to do, and I don't really have to think about it too much.
Yeah, you know, we at Artisan kind of go a few extra steps when we have to create Section 508 compliant content or accessible content. You know, there's a little bit to what I was saying earlier, there's meeting the requirements, and then there's making a usable course, and they're not one in the same. So if what you're trying to do is just meet the requirements, you know, you can do that, but it doesn't, some of the tools that we use today, especially some of the rapid e-learning authoring tools, that doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be all such a great user experience for the person that's relying on assistive technology. So we do a lot of things on top of just the requirements to really try to facilitate that better user experience.
What are some easy things that we can do as instructional designers that maybe we miss? Like, what do you see that, like, is just a super easy win that maybe we just overlook, and that everybody could just start doing right now, and that would be just helpful and a step in the right direction, even if it's a baby step? Is there anything?
Well, so one of the things that we do, I'm not sure it's a baby step, but I think it's a great way to kind of start out a course, is we ask the learner right up front, you know, title page of a course, next thing comes next that says, hey, are you using accessible technology? Yes or no? And we basically save their response in a variable, and we use that to determine whether we're going to automatically play narration in the course or automatically play videos in the course. So you can imagine if someone is using a screen reader in the background and the screen reader is announcing what's going on their screen, and all of a sudden your course comes up and your course is trying to play a video or talking through narration while you've got the screen reader in the background, you know, you've got competing things going on, competing audio, and it's just not a good user experience. So right off the bat, one of the things that we do is we just lay it straight out for our learners and say, hey, are you using accessible technology? Because we have media that's going to autoplay in this course, and you should probably turn that off.
Mm-hmm. That's brilliant. Yeah, then that's what I mean. And it's so easy. Everybody should just do that.
Absolutely. Mm-hmm.
I would even go so far as to suggest that autoplay isn't a great experience for anybody. You know, if you're in a loud environment, you know, you're one cubicle in a big room full of cubicles, lots of stuff going on, and you're trying to take in content, Your attention gets pulled over, and meanwhile, something has autoplayed. You know, you've missed something, you've got to back it up, that kind of a thing. So I think that's maybe even an example where the ways that we think we should be making something aren't really helpful for everybody, even though it kind of makes us feel good about how fancy it could be, right? That sense of what an amazing media experience. Oh, everything's just seamless and flows. But I've always been a proponent of simply giving people, you know, learners more control over their over the experience as a whole too. So yeah.
Patrick's got a great question and a reality, right? Like, let's do a reality check here. And Patrick, thank you for bopping us in the head for the reality check. It's going to cost us more. It's going to take a little extra time. And more often than not, I would say clients just don't want to pay for it. And when they hear how much extra it's going to cost or whatnot, it's like, well, maybe we can just get by without it for a little while. And then we'll come back to you, you know, if something goes wrong or whatever. And so how do you address, you know, questions like that?
You know, we deal with this all the time because we are a custom e-learning development shop also. So, you know, he's exactly right. You know, the additional effort that's required to go the extra steps to make sure a course is accessible, they do take extra time. And the testing on the back end to ensure that it actually works with screen readers, that takes extra time too. So what we've tried to do is we've tried to strike a balance with some of our clients. You know, we have several clients who aren't necessarily government, but they kind of want to do the right thing with respect to accessibility. So we barter with them a little bit, and we say, well, how about if we do at least some of the basic stuff? How about if we make sure that we're doing alt tags? You know, we make sure that we're getting closed captions for all of our video. So that was kind of that solution where I talked about earlier, whereas we call it 508 Lite. It would not pass the law, if you will, but at least it's taking strides in the right direction to make it as accessible as we can within a reasonable budget for our clients. So we try to do that with our clients a little bit, especially those who aren't held to the letter of the law. And on the other side, for those government clients who are held to the letter of the law, it seems in my experience and in working with them that they're committed to it. And so that budget issue just doesn't seem to come up with respect to, you know, taking the extra steps to make it 508 compliant, because they know that it's mandated and they have to do it.
Yeah, it's part of the expectation, and that expectation has to be met. Well, we've used the phrase 508, section 508, you know, a few times, and maybe we should define what that is for those folks in the audience who aren't, first off, who aren't American, because, you know, section 508 has become, for a lot of us anyway, sort of shorthand for accessibility as a whole, but it is technically a U.S. regulation. That said, here in Canada, largely our regulations parallel, you know, the exact same standards. So section 508 of the Rehabilitation Act, I believe it is, in the US. But then there's been another standard change, which Laura's just thrown in into the chat there too, that we're moving away from just referencing section 508 to a different set of standards, although, you know, accomplishing the same set of goals, the WCAG 2.0. And maybe we just talk a little bit about where that comes from, who's behind that, what that's all about.
Yeah, the back in January of 2018, our U.S. government sort of changed their Section 508 law to point to the WCAG 2.0, which is the Web Content Accessibility Standards. So previously, our U.S. government had their own checklist, if you will, of things that you had to do for Section 508 compliance. And it went back to, you know, technology that, quite frankly, we don't use anymore. So the laws were so outdated, and they were written around technology that we just don't use in our everyday lives, that they needed to be revamped in a bad way, because back when they were written, you know, websites just really didn't exist. So moving forward, beginning, they went through a whole process, several years of, you know, making sure that they wanted to point to these web content accessibility settings, lots of panels, lots of, you know, public comments, all that kind of stuff. And finally, in January 2018, the law went into place whereby, you know, if you are under that government mandate, Any content that you edit or create after January 2018 must adhere to the new law. And the new law, as I said, points to those web content accessibility standards. And the good thing about it is, to your point, is that it is very much more a international standard. So it is, it's done by the W3C. That's who is the owner of the WCAG, if you will. And, you know, Canada has embraced it. Australia has embraced it. There are a number of European countries who have embraced it. So it kind of brought the U.S. back in line with sort of world standards when it comes to this. And while our current U.S. law points to the WCAG 2.0, there's already a 2.1 out there. So these standards are very much evolving. And, you know, they're evolving along with our technology just for the whole purpose of making sure that we can cater to audiences that, you know, have different abilities than we do.
Yeah, you mentioned the W3C. I think that's a great link to drop in because it's a really, if you're talking about doing usability or you want responsive design, we've had a couple idiotic episodes talking about responsive design and how your content shows up in web browsers. You know, that website is just a wealth of information. They have training, they have tutorials, they have all the HTML tags, the WCAG, like you mentioned, is listed there. Everything about the web and those and any type of standard that's been created is listed there. So if you are an e-learning developer and you're hanging out with us today, you should know that site and you should be very versed in it. And if you haven't, you're welcome.
And I just dropped into chat there the link directly to the WCAG quick reference. Awesome. We are up to, like I said, they're up to version 2.1. Our law currently states 2.0. And one thing that's a little bit nice to know too about the WCAG is that they've got it kind of broken down into three different levels, single A, double A, and triple A. And essentially they're set up in such a way that if you, let's see how I can explain this properly. Single A is kind of the least level or the lowest level of the standard. And then double A is a next level up. But if you are striving for double A, which is essentially what our law points to, section 508 is the double A, then you have to meet all of the requirements that are listed in both A and double A. But then there's another step further that is triple A, which is kind of the above and beyond. And if you can hit those, that's ideal, but that's not a requirement by our law at the moment.
So where does your idea of 508 light land in that hierarchy?
It's probably somewhere closer to the single A. I think that's a great question. It's probably closer to somewhere in the single A area. So there are definitely some things that are excluded in that type of thing. That is a made up term. So even within our organization, while we kind of throw it around from client to client, it even means something different.
Yeah.
But as we talked a little bit about earlier, you know, for some of those clients who are not required to meet the web content accessibility guidelines, but kind of want to do the right thing, we try to pitch to them this concept of 508 light. You know, let's do a few things so that we can get a majority of your users in there and included in the content. And we'll skip some of the rigorous stuff that, you know, would take considerable extra time and effort. So like one example of one of those things that is pretty time consuming is that when you have video or you have any kind of synchronized on-screen events with audio content, the web content accessibility guidelines say that you have to have an audio narrated equivalent of everything that's happening. So the way I describe it is it's kind of like a narrated screenplay. So if you can imagine, you know, you have a screenplay that says, you know, a doctor walks on, Dr. Smith walks on screen and sits at a round table with patient Ed. And Ed is an elderly man and he's got a cane at his side. And there are some papers on the table and they're looking together at a laptop. Then Dr. Smith says, good morning, Ed, how are you? And Ed says, well, I'm not feeling so great today. And, you know, so a screenplay, if you will, as I refer to it, kind of hashes out everything that's happening within that scene. Well, according to WCAG, you have to have a narrated equivalent of that. So like in our world, you know, in order to get that narrated equivalent, we have to write it first. So what we provide to our learners is essentially a written version of it that has an option to play an audio version of it. If you can imagine the amount of effort that goes into that, you know, what we will usually start with is, you know, a transcription of the video or something like that. There are some good services out there such as 3Play Media, where you can send a video over and get a transcript and closed captions in return. So we'll start with a transcript, if you will, and then we'll add the commentary of what's actually going on screen. But then we have to actually get that narrated. So you can appreciate that the extra steps and the costs that go into doing all of those things is pretty substantial. And if you have more than just a handful of them within a course, it will quickly add up to the amount of time you have to spend creating that course.
Obviously, it's something that you need to budget for, like time-wise, even, and understand that from the beginning. And I'm just thinking out loud, but it'd be kind of neat if we were able to discover if there were any, I don't know, checklist kind of sites, et cetera, beyond, you know, the WCAG could be potentially overwhelming maybe for some people just starting to get in, but
definitely overwhelming.
Yeah, there's a lot going on there. One of the things I was thinking as we were talking too is in some ways, once in a while, the advancing of technology actually improves things. And where I'm coming from is that, I think one of the best things that for our space has happened for accessibility has been the basic leaving of Flash behind, because Flash was such a bear and a horrible experience for anyone with a screen reader in particular, and the time and effort to whereas HTML-based content is so much more, you know, fluidly accessible, directly accessible than by screen reader technology. So once in a while, out with the old, in with the new, actually does make things, you know, better overall too. So,
yeah. Well, I'm going to drop a link into the chat here. I came across these posters just last week, actually, on LinkedIn. I am quite often looking around LinkedIn and for any kind of accessibility resources. But these came out of the UK, actually, the UK's Home Office, and I just really like them a lot. They break down into very simple terms and very simple things what you can do to help make your courses accessible. And I really like them. They really just kind of struck a chord with me in how simple they make it and how simple they talk about some of the requirements there. And, you know, simple things like when you're creating buttons, you know, make sure that button has some text that is meaningful. So instead of just click here, you know, maybe it's download document or download form or whatever it might be, you know. So just small changes like that where you're adding a little bit more description so it's obvious what's going to happen for the user is not just a requirement for accessibility, but in my opinion, it's just good design.
Well, that's your description of that right there is actually, you know, a good example of effective use of microcopy from the marketing world, where you don't tell people to click the button. The button simply says what the action is going to be, and people understand that, they get to it quicker. Reduces the, you know, the fluffiness and et cetera too. It's a more effective way of communicating, not just about solving an accessibility problem, but it is, like you say, just a better way to approach, you know, the design of that, for sure. Yeah. Neat stuff. Yeah.
Those hidden elements though, that I think would be interesting. And I, it's something I ignore a lot. And that's that alt tag that you mentioned a little bit earlier back when you're talking about images in HTML, right? When you're, even if you're using a WYSIWYG editor, there's always that little field down there that says, you know, to enter some alt text, you know, and how many of us really take the time to enter in some really descriptive text that explains what that is a picture of for those people who can't see what the picture is that you've put on the screen. And it's not that big of an extra step to go to fill in that alt tag more often than not. But I think I'll be the first to admit that I skip it because it's just an extra step in the process. And I don't really think about it too much, but I should.
Yeah, it's an easy one, right? That's kind of some low hanging fruit in all of this, is that just adding those alt tags, it does take a little bit of extra effort, a little bit of extra time. What we find is often what's the bigger problem is not the act of actually typing the alt text, it's figuring out what the alt text should be in the first place. So depending on the image, you know, there's this balance of how much detail do you put into the description of that? Yeah. And, you know, what I just try to reiterate is that if that image conveys meaning in any way, shape, or form, get to the gist of the meaning in as few words as possible. Try to describe that image so that the meaning of whatever it is you're trying to convey is conveyed through that description.
Sounds like the making of a good tutorial, how to write a good alt tag.
I would suggest that, as you were describing, if it has meaning at all, I would suggest that if you're struggling to write the alt text to explain what the image means in the context of what you're showing, maybe the image is just there for fluff anyway. And is it even really, you know, relevant, right? Which could lead you then to be making a better design decision, you know, overall, maybe. I don't know. Sometimes we get too many pictures beside bullets that, you know, the pictures are barely related because somebody did a clip art search or whatever. So Joe Cook's thrown in a couple of comments the alt tag always used to be good for SEO too, search engine optimization. Not sure if it still is, but certainly that kind of thing can play in. And it's good for mouse over or if images don't load for some reason. So alt tag is not just an exclusive, you know, thing for a screen reader. It does have other roles for the broader, you know, group of your audience. As she mentions, it's good design all around. So, and Laura chimed in with double exclamation marks on people need to be trained on writing the alt text. And yeah, there is a bit of an art form, you know, to that. You've always got to be making sure that you're trying to be helpful for sure. Yeah. We're getting a little close to our wrap up here time, Brent. Let's flip over to that article that you found, because that one quote that we were talking about at the beginning of things here was pretty bang on, and I think summarizes a lot of not the technical thing that we're trying to achieve here, but maybe the spirit of things. So just maybe, Brent, tell us where this is from. Maybe throw the link, too, into the chat there.
Yeah, for sure. And this is so Microsoft actually has a Medium account. For those of you that use Medium.com as sort of a blogging platform, Microsoft has an account there. I'll shrink this down, or at least I thought I was going to. There we go. And grab the link real quick. And I'll drop it in. But I thought this was pretty cool. Just when I was looking around earlier when we were in the green room, and Microsoft writes it in this way: there's a beauty in recognizing exclusion. It calls on our humanity and our powers of empathy. And when we answer that call, beautiful things happen for our products, our customers, and us.
That's really a really cool summary of looking at this not as a, you know, a burden or as extra effort, but by making it core, something new, something better, you know, can emerge out of all of this for sure.
Yeah. I wanted to add one thing. Just, I like to start adding more tips and things. And so books are always a good thing to add at the end of our shows, I think. And so the closest thing I could find in my collection that I wanted to share today was this book. And I highly recommend it to people. If you've never read The Design of Everyday Things, this was originally written, I forget what version it's on, but it was originally written a long time ago. But it still holds true today. The Nielsen Norman Group is a consulting firm, but he's pretty much considered sort of the Donald Norman, the godfather of usability and good design. And that's just sort of it's a good primer. It's an easy read, it's a fun read, and it really, really makes you think about all sorts of different design elements. So when people say, Brent, what's a good book to read for someone that's new to instructional design? I always have two lists. One is the actual instructional design stuff, and then the non-instructional design world that, but also directly applies to the work that we do. And this always lands at the top of that non-instructional design list.
Very cool. I tossed that into the chat for anybody who wants to grab that and do a quick search of the interwebs to perhaps locate a copy of that. So yeah, cool. We've reached our time limit here today. Tanya, thanks so much for joining us. This is, as Brent said, we've been looking into this topic for something for a while, and it was really awesome to be able to discover some of the things that you've put out there on this. It's a really, really important thing that we all need to have better conversations about and get better at and learn to do better things in this range. Because there's lots of subtle things that we can get into. There's lots of things to consider. Biggest thing is probably just getting started. Get on it. Pitter patter, let's get at her.
Yeah, for sure. Tanya, cool. It's so great to meet you face to face and to have you on the show today. Thanks for joining us.
Thanks so much for having me. Super appreciate it and happy to talk about the topic. Small steps can go a long way. So this one is one that's kind of close to my heart and I enjoy talking about it. So thanks for having me.
Awesome. Thanks so much. Hey, everybody, thanks for joining us today. We'll catch you guys next week. And in the meantime, have coffee.
Enjoy yourselves, everybody.